Oh boy, long time no see. It's been a while to say the least. It's been, I think, 4 months, 5 months since I've released a video. It may even be 6 by the time this comes out. So half a year without a Doom Says video. Around half a year, for a Doom Says video. Sorry, it's just, you know, 2020. That's all I really have to say, 2020. There's nothing like a fucking global pandemic to absolutely destroy someone's creative drive. It also doesn't help that I've been working on a video for around a couple months now. It's going to be, at this point, almost an hour long, so... Great. Eventually that'll be released and then everything will just go back to normal, hopefully. Oh no. It's been a fucking weird year, man. Anyways, here's some movie crumbs you can enjoy. Just aid the wait. More of these might come out, I don't know. Anyways, yeah, movie crumbs. Do I really have to review another fucking Jackass film? It's Jackass. It's fucking Jackass. What do you want from me? Fucking 6 out of 10, it's Jackass. So, there's literally only one reason I wanted to watch this, and that's because Jonah Hill directed and wrote this film. I didn't even really know what it was about. I mean, I knew it took place during the 90s, of course, but that's about it. And after watching it twice, I can say that, yep, this is a pretty good film. And definitely a strong start to Jonah Hill's possible career as a director. Hopefully that's not a wrong prediction. First thing I should point out is that mid-90s definitely feels like it's out of the 90s. It's in 4x3, there's lots of skating and hip-hop and old video games, and everyone talks like they did in the 90s. It feels very 90s. Now, of course, I didn't live in the 90s, but many people have said that it feels realistic to the time, and from the 90s media I have consumed, I feel this would be pretty similar to what it's like. Now, the story is pretty generic. It's about a boy who tries to fit in with some cool friends, only to realize that there's a lot more going on beneath the surface. I've seen this sort of story dozens of times, but at least mid-90s has a semi-unique spin on it, even if it's not by much. The characters are all pretty fleshed out to their own degree. There's some interesting things that happen in the film, and the drama does mount to a pretty good climax and ending, which, while sudden, is very fitting. Overall, this is a pretty good coming-of-age film with a 90s aesthetic, which you may like if you're into that sort of thing. Not the most original story, but the characters and tone are definitely enough to pull it through. It's also a very strong debut for Jonah Hill. Overall, 7 out of 10. Oh boy. Hey, you wanna watch something that just makes you feel really bad? Like, really bad? Well, here you go. The Final Quarter is a documentary about AFL player Adam Goods and his last 3 years playing footy. Now, I've watched this before as it premiered on 7 and I was able to catch it, so when I saw it again on Stan, I thought, well, I remember it being good, so why not? If only I remembered what I felt like after watching it. This is one of those films that just makes you feel gross after watching. You can say what you want about the events, whether it was actual racism or simply people disliking him, but either way, the film is about a player who didn't do all that much being forced to retire from a game he once loved. It's not an easy story to sit through, and it really puts into question how we view racism here in Australia and how we should treat it. Is this a case of racism? Should he have deserved better? Does this deserve looking into? The film doesn't really say anything, as it's made out of archival footage from the time, and it's really up to you whether or not it's racist. Personally, I think it's a case of accidental racism, where people simply join onto the hate train without realizing how real their actions really are. But again, it's up to you. It's what you personally think of the story. My only problem with the documentary I had was the editing. I think I'm starting to learn that I don't really like documentary editing, and this film isn't much different. Randomly, the aspect ratio will change and it's supposed to be more dramatic, but it just comes off as distracting for me. There's often big sweeping music that kicks in sometimes, like it's a blockbuster. But if anything, it takes away from how serious the scene is. but for the most part, I enjoyed it. If this sounds interesting to you, then I recommend it, although I doubt it knowing my audience. Overall, 7 out of 10. So, I'm kind of putting these two together because both of them have similar premises, similar strengths, but also similar flaws. Both plots are about a gay person who gets found out and is sent to a gay conversion clinic slash camp to try and make them straight, but spoilers, it doesn't work, and the conversion camp spirals out of control. Now, there are differences with the movie, mostly in tone. Boy Erased plays out like a realistic family drama, and that tone makes sense because it's based on a true story. Miseducation, as I'm going to refer to it from now on, is a lot more theatrical and is more of a low-key character study, and that tone also makes sense because it's based on a book. Both films are well acted, competently directed and shot, and both are decently written overall. But that's also my main problem with both of these films. I found that both films just sort of lacked impact or memorability. They're not bad films, but after they were done, I didn't really feel like I needed to revisit them. Both were just average. Both had separate flaws, of course. Boy Erased is told out of order for no reason, it doesn't help the story at all, and no surprises are offered because you can already tell where the story is heading. It also can drag quite a bit at points. Miseducation has interesting ideas, but it doesn't really explore them deep enough. There's interesting things that are brought up, but then they kind of just fade into the background for another slightly interesting idea to come forward, only to disappear and so forth. I felt this most at the ending, where you kind of just left like, oh, okay, it's over. Now, both films can be pretty strong at points. Both films have me glued to the screen at certain times, especially around the climaxes. Both have a good lead actor, and both do explore a story that is interesting. I did have a good time watching these two films. There is good stuff in these films, but I just feel that they don't go far enough to show it. But who knows, maybe you'll like them more than I did. Overall, I'm giving both films a 6 out of 10. Okay, before I continue, you will not understand this film. I repeat, you will not understand this film. This film is complex and confusing, and unless you have a big brain, you won't understand it. The premise of the film sounds quite simple. It's about two scientists who accidentally invent a time machine, so they start using it only to have everything inevitably be thrown into a mind-bending tailspin with clones, paradoxes, and multiple time machines going on at the same time. The thing that separates this film from other time-traveling films is 1. The very low budget, only being $7,000, and 2. The complex story and dialogue, which you will not understand. This film falls under a subgenre of sci-fi called hard sci-fi, which I think you can guess from the title what hard sci-fi is like. Very complex and sciencey dialogue with stories that are meant to confuse the ever-loving hell out of you. Crime is a film that really depends on what you want out of a film. If you want a straightforward sci-fi or sci-fi heavy on characters, then look elsewhere. If you're looking for a sci-fi that is outside the norm, or a sci-fi with a confusing and complex story, this is your film. But even outside of the confusing dialogue and story, this film still has a lot to offer. The directing is very good. The acting is decent for the most part. There's some pretty good editing. I really like the music. And even if the story and dialogue is confusing, it's done in such a way that constantly keeps you intrigued throughout the entire film. The dialogue is fast and snappy and filled with science gibberish, and the story is thrilling and weird and confusing. There are some problems with the film. The audio can be pretty bad, the main characters don't have a lot of personality, and the budget can be very apparent at times, but for the most part, I really enjoyed this film. I genuinely mean when I say that I've never really seen a film like this. This is going to be a film which you'll either love or completely hate, but I do recommend you watch it at least once. Because even if you do hate it, you can at least agree that it's definitely a unique film. 7 out of 10. Alright, so yeah, that's my movie crumbs. Expect a lot of these, seeing how, like, you know, this video is gonna take a while. And I've watched a lot of fucking films during quarantine, so this is not even covering, like, a quarter of them that I watched. Maybe not even a tenth, to be honest. So, yeah, expect, a fair amount of these movie crumbs down the pipeline. I might even do just a giant video just filled with movie crumbs, maybe. I don't know. Depends on how I'm feeling. So yeah, thanks for watching. 2020 is coming to an end soon, thank fucking God, and see you around. Goodbye.